And hello and welcome to episode 7 of War of the Stars, a Star Wars roundtable podcast. I'm your host, Mark Tolley. Joining me as always, after having recently escaped from in the Imperial prison, rescuing yours truly, is Mario Hernandez. Also joining us today is Christina Talley.
You guys.
Brian is currently in a back to tank, recovering from his wounds from that daring escape from the Imperial prison. And we are coming to you, as always, from deep within the Outer Rim, far beyond the watchful eyes of the Galactic Empire. So, guys, how's it going?
It's going good.
Going pretty good.
All right.
Can we move a little bit further away from the sun? No, it's getting really hot. Just saying.
Well, I mean, that's what you get when you decide to film from Tatooine and the two suns there. I mean, come on, what do you expect? So, I thought we'd start. We talked a little bit last week on the Han Solo situation, and since Mario wasn't there, I thought we would start by getting his thoughts on that whole situation and what his opinions are and thoughts are, and kind of where he's thinking this is going to be going, and just his general thoughts on it.
Okay, well, first thing is, this is a big, big mess. This is the worst thing that could happen to a movie studio with a movie that people don't really want. The general consent is that people don't want this movie. A lot of people don't. I personally am open to it, but for the most part, people do not want this movie. And then you have all this news break out that, you know, the directors get fired and that he needs an acting coach and that he's on probation, that he might get even kicked off. You know, your main actor might get kicked out of the movie if he doesn't improve. And it contradicts everything we heard a couple months before, that, you know, that Alden was doing an amazing job and he really nailed Han Solo. And pretty much just everything going on with this movie is a big mess. The public is just smashing this movie every chance they get. They're changing of what actually happened. What I actually think happened is that, okay, the Phil Lord and Chris Miller, they have a distinct style to their filmmaking, like Edgar Wright, like Tarantino. You can tell when a movie is theirs. And the first couple of days of shooting, you know, Kathleen was there to see, to make sure the ship went in the right direction, and you know they followed by the rules because she was there watching them. And then after a couple of days, she was like, you know what, okay, I'm gonna go leave, I'm gonna go work on episode 8 stuff. And then she leaves, and then we have just them. They're there, they're the ones in charge, they're the next in the chain of command. And that's when they started kind of, you know what, let's slowly start doing things our way. And then, I mean, she's not here, she's not gonna see this until it's too late, so let's go away from the script, let's go away from what we said we would do. Let's just make our own movie. And then, of course, Alden goes and pretty much blows the whistle on them. Well, I think it was a good thing that he did this, just because I think he pretty much saved the movie. When it comes to your main actor, that the directors are not doing what they're supposed to do, yeah, he shouldn't have done that. It wasn't in his place. But I think we have him to thank for getting Ron Howard to come and direct this movie. I'm glad that Ron Howard is directing this movie. He's a veteran director, he knows what to do, and he knows Star Wars. He has had his hand in Star Wars before. So, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I kind of agree. I think that was a good choice to come in and write the ship. I don't know if it's going to be a situation where, I don't know if it's going to be like what Joss Whedon is doing in Justice League, where he's just coming in as a stopgap just to kind of finish out, or if it's going to be something different, if it's going to be something of, okay, we're going to completely change this movie, we're going to do a ton of reshoots and a ton of do-overs and basically shoot half the movie over again.
From what I'm hearing is that they are going to be shooting the scenes they need to reshoot that were not following the script. Last I heard, he was reviewing all the footage they have taken already, so they're pretty much going through and looking at the script and like, just going through everything going, all right, we can leave this, but this we got to redo, kind of deal.
Yeah. Yeah. I think the biggest concern a lot of people have is the fact that, you know, we're only like a few weeks, you know, supposed to be just a few weeks away from the movie, the original time frame for the movie to stop, to wrap up. And I think it's, what is it, less than a year before it's supposed to come out?
11 months, I think.
11 months, yeah. So I think that's what everyone's biggest concern is we're 11 months out from this, you know, premiering, and we're, you know, talking about a new director. We're talking about reshoots and stuff like that. But then again, didn't we have this problem with Rogue One? We had up to the last minute, almost reshoots, almost up to the last minute.
Well, also,
and Rogue One turned out awesome.
Well, also remember that a lot of studios, they have time after their principal photography is finished with, they actually have a section of time for reshoots.
Yeah.
As they're going through editing and starting to process all this footage, they say, okay, well, this didn't come out right. This is not what we need. We need to redo it. They have a pretty significant chunk of time to be able to go through and reset it up. So as far as time crunch wise, it's not as bad as it seems.
Yeah. 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 But yeah, I think, like I was saying earlier, I think it's, I have skeptical optimism, I guess is the best way to describe it, is I'm optimistic, but cautious optimism. That's what I'm looking for. Cautious optimism with this. I mean, I'll definitely see it in Star Wars. I'll definitely see it. But as far as, and I think also Rogue One kind of gave me a little bit of hope. You know, Rogue One kind of said, okay, these movies can be good. They can be entertaining. But at the same time, I don't know if you were to tell me of all the characters, you were to say, which one would you like to see a movie of, you know, standalone movie about, Han Solo would not be the first name I would think of, to be honest with you. As much as I love Han, I mean, Han is a great character, you know, one of my favorites from the original trilogy. He's not like, definitely not the one that I'd be like, I want to see a Han Solo movie. But because for me, I think it's, for one thing, it's a couple of things. For me, it's Han is one of those characters that is very much, when I think of Han, I think of one person. I think of Harrison Ford. And to see someone else in that role is going to be very, very weird for me. To see anyone else wearing that vest and in that seat is going to be very, very weird. I mean, like all the other character people that are going to be in it, I can see someone else playing Lando. I think the guy that got to play Lando was a perfect casting. But as far as Han goes, I don't know if I can see anyone else but Harrison Ford in that role.
I mean, yeah, I pretty much agree with you. The whole Han Solo movie, that's its biggest challenge. It can be a great movie, it can be a great, you know, film with all, you know, all these side characters, but the main thing you have to sell everyone on is this new, is Alden Ehrenreich as Han Solo. If you don't succeed in that first trailer, he doesn't feel like Han Solo without being too much of a copy of Harrison Ford while still making it his own, the movie fails. This whole entire movie rests on his shoulders.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, definitely.
I mean, the other thing, I mean, I agree with that completely. And, yeah, Han Solo, I mean, that's one of those, it's the same thing as, like, you know, like, no one else could really ever play Grand Moff Tarkin except for Peter Cushing.
Yeah.
So it's other characters that are been so iconic. Like, I don't think anyone else could voice Darth Vader other than James Earl Jones.
Yeah, I agree. Although some of the people that have done it in some of the cartoons have done a decent job.
But it's not the same thing. It ruins it.
Yeah, that, I agree.
But also at the same time,
people from like my generation and your generation, Christina, probably we thought the same thing about well, no one except for no one else could play Ben Kenobi, except for I can't even think of his name now, Sir
Alec Guinness.
Alec Guinness, yeah. I don't know why my brain
it
just
happens
went
to
dead
all
there.
Of us, believe me.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, a lot of people our age thought, well, no one can play Obi-Wan Kenobi but Alec Guinness. He was perfect in that role. And then, you know, the prequels come out, and I think we got one of the best Obi-Wan Kenobis, I think, as far as, you know, being that character. But I think part of that was because he studied Alec Guinness. He studied the mannerism, he studied how he talked, how he walked, you know, everything about him. So when you put them side by side and see it, you can see, okay, I can see him becoming that character. I can see him as he gets older becoming that Alec Guinness character. And I think that's going to be the key. If the guy who's playing Han Solo can do that, then I think we might have a good film.
My skepticism is also the story too. I mean, we all, like a lot of us who read Extended Universe, know what they have presented to us as the beginnings of Han Solo. It's Han Solo as the Imperial officer who ends up running away, like, you know, helping Chewbacca escape, and in turn is why Chewbacca has a life debt with Han Solo, why he's so guarded of Han Solo.
Yeah.
I think if they go with any other storyline than what was already presented to us, it's going to cause an issue.
I think it depends on where they start in Han's life. Do they start with him as like you said, as the Imperial, or do they just kind of do it like, okay, he's already a smuggler, he's already out there, they don't really do an origin story, they just kind of put it out there as he's out there, him and Chewbacca are already together, and this is just an adventure they have together.
See, like, I don't think that would do... If they do that, I don't think it's going to be any justice to the storyline. It'll just make this movie that much more disliked. If you're going to do a Han Solo movie, then you need to do a Han Solo Origins movie. I mean, there's the only way around it. It's the only way it's going to work at this point, especially with the turmoil it's already have. It's not an origin story. If it's just like, hey, then it shouldn't be Han Solo. It should be the, you know, like, the adventures of Han Solo and Chewbacca. I mean, so I really feel it needs to be an origin story at this point for it to work.
Yeah. Now, have you heard if they've, because I know there was something going around that they had decided that Han was not going to be his real name, and that in the movie we would learn his real name. Do you know if that's been, if there's that still the plan, or I didn't know if that was still in the works?
I think
or...
it's been a rumor, but at the same time, I actually like the idea, and I agree with it if they do it that way, especially if it follows his origin story of his time with the Empire, because somebody who leaves the Empire not always is welcome to leave the Empire, as we saw in Rogue One. So if you're going to leave the Empire and you're going to turn around and to become, especially in a legal profession like a smuggler, you're probably going to want to change your name.
Yeah.
I mean, from what I heard that, you know, that whole statement about Han getting his name, I heard that it was a misunderstanding from whoever actually said the line into how the what do you call him, a reporter took it. I heard that the actual statement was that you're going to find out why Han got his name or how he got his name. Not as in like he's, you know, going to get a different name or he had a different name, but as in how he's going to become the Han Solo that we know.
So like his reputation.
Yeah. Like how does
how he got his reputation. This character?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, that kind of makes a little bit more sense. Yeah. Yeah, I can see that. I mean, I can see that. I mean, I'm kind of skeptical because I don't, like, to me it's like, you know, we've grown up with this character as being Han Solo. And you know, to suddenly find out that, oh, that's not his, but then again, they did the same thing with Indiana Jones. Where you find out
Indy was the name of the dog in Temple.
Yeah, Indy was the name of the dog. Yeah,
in Last Crusade.
Yeah,
Indy. We named the dog Indy. I love that movie. Like, that was one of the few
Yes.
third like a lot of people didn't like it. I loved it. That banter between Sean Connery and Harrison Ford was epic the entire time.
Oh, yeah. You can't go wrong with Sean Connery. I'm sorry. He's just, yeah, I know he's Scottish, but he's a national treasure.
I mean, the only movie, he has very few flop movies, and they're not his fault when they go. I mean, if he can't save a movie, no one can. He's one of those kind of people.
Yeah.
Like League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, he couldn't even save that movie. It was that bad.
What? Oh. So, anything else on your guys' minds? Anything coming up, or
let me pose a question to the panel. With the whole Han Solo news, how do you guys think that's gonna affect the D23 announcements if we're getting any from Lucasfilm?
I don't think it will. Personally, I don't think it's gonna show any bearing. I think they're gonna go ahead and they're still gonna give us a full length trailer for it. They're gonna release the official title. And they're going to go on as planned, because if they do anything but what's expected right now with this movie, it's just going to cause more turmoil and more issues and more, you know, more people speaking out on the internet going, oh, this movie's going to be a disaster, yada, yada, yada. But if they come and they present an actual trailer and they present everything they need, they're expected to present at D23, I don't think it's going to be an issue. I think they're going to have to. Disney needs to at this point just to save themselves on this.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. I don't think there's going to be any issues with it. I think you're just going to, this is Disney we're talking about. This is a major company. So if anyone can get through this, it's the mouse. The mouse can...
I mean, with the mouse, I mean, I swear they said it the best in Doctor Strange. Like, I know we're going a little off topic here, but it applies to this, because they said it's very expensive but possible. And, you know, that would be Disney's aspect. I'm just looking for possible. Like, they don't care about expense when it comes to certain, when they want to do something. Oh. They just care about if it's possible or not.
Yeah.
I have a question for you guys as well. So if we get a Han Solo trailer, do you think we will hear him all then talk, or do you think we'll just see him?
I think that could go either way. I guess it's too much with problem with trailers is we can't really judge. I would like to hear him talk, because I think that'll make or break, but I think it's going to also make or break the movie. Because if his voice is way off of what we expect it to sound like from our years and years of Harrison Ford, then it's like like us old time fans, like us fans who've been fans since, you know, the original trilogies, are not going to be able to tolerate it, because we're like, this is not Han Solo. This is not Han Solo. That's all it's going to go through our head. This is not Han.
Yeah.
So it's a risky move
That goes back to what I was saying about Ewan McGregor and Alec Guinness. Is what made Ewan McGregor's Obi-Wan so good was, like I said, the fact that he studied Alec Guinness. And he studied because Han has a particular way he talks, a particular cadence. It's not just the swagger and the cockiness and everything like that. It's the inflection in how he talks, how he responds to people, how he holds his, you know, it's everything. It's like with any actor, so any character that is that, been around that long, has become that iconic. There's a particular way that character talks and acts and responds to people. And I think that's what anybody who plays that character needs to do, is study not just Harrison Ford, but study Han Solo. Study that character, watch all the movies, and see how he talks and how he inflects and everything like that. And if he doesn't, like you said, it's just going to flop. You just can't put a vest on somebody and make him say, okay, and act all cocky and arrogant and be the quote unquote scoundrel if you don't have that voice.
That's exactly my point. I mean, like, if his voice does not, let's be honest, we all at this point have an idea in our head what the voice needs to sound like. And let's not forget too, you're bringing up Ewan McGregor. Let's not forget, after episode one released, there was a lot of people who were speaking out against Ewan McGregor playing, like, I can't believe this. This is horrible. It took us, pretty much the other two trilogies to warm up to the Ewan McGregor Obi-Wan.
Yeah.
And now it's like, wow, he does an amazing job. But at first, there were a lot of people who were not happy with it because it wasn't Alec Guinness.
Yeah,
this is to the me, problem the when you scene... replace. This is what happens when you replace a major character. This is the problem when you replace an actor like this. It could fall under a lot of skepticism, even if the person does an amazing job. It's still skepticism.
Yeah, to me, the line in that Ewan McGregor did that was like, okay, that was sounded so much like Alec Guinness was the hello there when he drops down and says hello there. That was almost exactly like what. Alec Guinness said when he first meets R2, when he meets R2 in the desert, and he says, hello there. Same inflection, same tone. It was almost like, okay, I'm hearing Ewan McGregor about 20 years later.
Yeah, I read it.
Hold on a sec, guys. I'll be right back.
Okay.
Yeah, so.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Do you think we'll get anything at Comic-Con, which is the week after D23?
I doubt it, because I think Disney will want to keep all of their big announcements for themselves. He was just asking if we think we'll get anything for Comic-Con that wasn't revealed at D23.
Probably not. D23 wants, they want D23 to be their con. It's Disney's con.
So
they're going to give all the hot surprise. They're not going to save anything to release at another con when they can release it at D23, especially how close like SDCC is after, I think it's like a week away or 2 weeks after D23.
Yeah.
1 week.
So.
Yeah, I don't think so. I think Disney, like you said, I think Disney is going to want to have everything themselves and release everything for themselves. They're not gonna. I think they might. Do you think they won't do anything for like Marvel, any of the Marvel movies at Comic-Con, or do you think they'll do that at D23 too?
I think it'll be the same thing, because they want D23 to beat their con to be successful. So why would you save something for another person's con that you can draw revenue and draw popularity to your own con?
I'll just wait for
SDCC to hear about this, the new Marvel movies. No, they're gonna really drop that at D23. I mean, it's just, it makes sense on a business standpoint.
I mean, I'm going to D23 actually, so I'm gonna be there for the live action panel to see what they're
filming too. I want to see lots of footage
if they let me. So I'm going to be there for the Lucasfilm panel, the Marvel panels. I'm going to see everything they're going to show. I really think they're going to show everything at D23. Like Christina said, they want to make this the con to go to.
Yeah. And while you're there, don't forget, promote the channel.
Right?
I'll think I get a shirt by then, or something, a hat, or something to really promote there.
Yes. See if you can get an interview with Kathleen. Maybe that would be cool.
Or maybe Ewan McGregor or someone.
Yeah. Heck, Hayden Christensen would be fine too. I would be happy with that.
Anyone would.
Yeah.
Warwick Davis, actually, I think he would be one of
David would be awesome, because not only can you touch on him about his time doing Star Wars stuff, you can also touch base about Willow and about Harry Potter.
Yeah. One guy I would like to do, I think it would be really cool to do an interview, and I've heard he's like really cool with fans, is Matt Lanter. He did the voice of Anakin in the Clone Wars series.
Uh-huh.
I've heard he's really good. He's really cool and really is like loves interacting with the fans and stuff like that. And I think that would be really cool to interview with him or just to talk with him sometime. But that's pipe dream down the road sometime, maybe when we get bigger. We can, but
you know, I'm just thinking of the 23 for the Lucasfilm panel. What if it's all like they're just sitting up there, and then all of a sudden you see Ewan McGregor jump down from the ceiling. He's like, "Hello there," and then they announce the Kenobi movie.
That would be awesome, actually. I'm not even gonna lie, that would be awesome.
Yes. Well, that seems to be the
he
new
really
thing.
He has to jump. He just has to walk up there on stage and be like, "Hello," and that's it. And then we'll all know as soon as you see, you know, Ewan McGregor walking up there. Yeah, they're already talking about the new movie projects, and here comes just Ewan McGregor walk out and just, like, say hi. We know very well what's going to happen shortly after that.
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, that seems to be the new thing is for... It started with Tom Hiddleston a couple years ago at Comic-Con coming out as Loki, is to have one of the stars completely dressed in their... they did it with Rogue One with...
Critic.
Coming out when they announced the cast, and he came out in his full Imperial uniform, completely flanked by the two Death Troopers as he came up.
That's awesome.
So I think that's like the new thing is for, you know, one of the stars to completely dress up almost cosplay style at the cons. So I wouldn't. I mean, it wouldn't surprise me if they did do an Obi-Wan movie if McGregor didn't come out in full Jedi robe.
Exactly.
Which would be awesome.
Yeah, it would. But yeah, I knew you could get a camera. Okay, you could sneak a camera pretty easily. You have one on your phone, so.
Yeah.
You can film. Yeah. Film, report, be awesome.
I mean, I'm really hoping we get some kind of trailer, something different for, it could be episode 8, but honestly, this is off topic, but I'm really hoping for something for Infinity War. Some kind of footage or something.
Yeah. Yeah. It's exciting times coming up, I'll say that much. We got episode 8 coming out this Christmas. We got comic book movies galore coming out. It's just going to be a really, really exciting time for if you're a geek, if you're a nerd, it's going to be fun.
This is true.
Let
me ask you guys a... about Loud last night was about our influence on popular culture, so
yeah
let me ask you guys a question. Okay, so if you had to pick between the Royal Guards or the Death Troopers to escort you, which one would you pick?
Death Troopers.
I pick Royal Guards. I don't know. I just love that those crimson red uniforms are just really cool.
I just think the Death Troopers as opposed to like a regular Stormtrooper were definitely a lot more efficient. They were.
Oh yeah.
They were like super elite, and they were definitely high end for battle. So.
They could hit things. Yeah. So.
Yes.
Well, because what I've heard the stories is. The Death Troopers had to go through, like, basically they had to be almost reprogrammed. Like, they had to have special surgeries and stuff like that to make them almost... I wouldn't want to have to go through all that type of thing, whereas, like, the Imperial Guards were just highly trained, highly motivated, you know, special forces soldiers who were just... Yeah. And there's a reason why they were the ones that guarded the Emperor. And that why he didn't have the Death Troopers guard him. Why he had the Imperial Guards. You know, to me, there's a reason for that. Is because they were the best of the best of the best.
Well, the Death Guard, as far as I know, as far as lore's going right now, as far as the Death Troopers are going, they were an experimental unit headed by Krennic. That's why Krennic had them guarding him. But when they died, so did the whole program, because Krennic died too.
Yeah. Do you think that the Death Troopers are like the new canon's answer to the Dark Troopers in Legends?
I think so, yes.
That also brings up another thing. I've seen a guy did a video on this, and several people have talked about this, of why you don't see, like, why you didn't see, like, U-Wings in the rest of the trilogy, why you didn't see the Death Troopers or these other, like, the Shore Troopers and stuff like that throughout the rest of the trilogy. And he points out, this guy pointed out that, well, with the U-Wing was a troop transport.
Yeah.
It was a medium troop transport. So you wouldn't need, like, with the Battle of Yavin, that wouldn't have been needed. You wouldn't need a troop.
The only battle even could have been used in was the Battle of Endor. The Moon of Endor. But however, they had to sneak down there in a landing shuttle, so it wouldn't have been used there too.
And as far as like you were saying with the Death Troopers, they were a small experimental core. So again, there would be, probably no need, they would have thought of a need for them there. And same with the Shore Troopers, they were a specialized unit.
And also, specialized as well as the TIE Striker. I mean, the TIE Striker is a fantastic looking aircraft.
Yeah.
However, it was an atmospheric aircraft. It was designed to battle in atmosphere.
Yeah.
That's why it's a lot more sleek than a TIE fighter. Because if you look at the design of a TIE fighter, if that thing hits atmosphere, it's going to do horrible. Let's be honest. Oh, it has no aerodynamics whatsoever. It's got a ball. It's like a ball and two waffles glued together. Yeah, or two pieces of bread. The TIE Striker, that is an aerodynamic piece of equipment right there. That's what it's. Yeah. You can tell it's designed to actually be able to battle well and fast in atmosphere.
It makes sense to the way it's designed. Actually, makes some sense.
I mean, the only ships you really can't justify, you really have to question why they weren't in the other movies, other than the fact that we know that that movie was made, 20, 30 years after?
Yeah.
Is the TIE Striker, because you could have seen a TIE Striker going with that, once again, in Moon of Endor. You could have seen a TIE Striker flying across the sky in Tatooine.
You
could have seen those ships pop up in very different planets. And also the Lambda cargo ships.
Oh yeah, definitely.
Yeah,
I mean, those you would have seen them touching down and taking off of. You wouldn't have been using a landing shuttle. You would have been using a cargo ship to move supplies.
Yeah,
That's just common sense. So
yeah, that's one of those things that I know that there's the big thing about the redos and the special editions, but that's one thing. If they were going to do another, is to maybe add some of those into like landing scenes in the background of like Endor. Of seeing like those shuttles landing and taking off and stuff like that. That would make some sense, but I also would have liked to have seen some interdictors at some point in the series, because playing the original TIE Fighter and X-Wing, that was always one of my favorite ships, were the interdictor cruisers.
Some of the other more known ships, like more interceptors, more bombers.
Yeah.
I mean, we never see any of those ships a whole lot. I mean, the most we saw the Interceptor was what? Return of the Jedi?
Yeah. I think that was the first time they really showed up was Jedi.
They had so many other off-ball designs. Let's not forget that one. It has the central. I can't remember what they called it, but it had the central wing, and it had the two cockpits, and one of them was actually just a turbo laser.
Mm, that's not the bomber.
No, it was some weird experimental thing they came up with. It had an outer hull, it had an outer cockpit instead of an inner cockpit. The wing was in the center, and then it had a turbo laser slapped on the other side of it.
Mm.
Like a flying fighter with a turbo laser. That's a pretty scary thing if you think about it.
Yeah, yeah. I remember the TIE Defender. That was the one that had the ball in the middle. It had the wing on top.
Yeah, the tri-wing ship, yeah.
The tri-wing, yeah, like the three, and the wings were kind of curved. And also the B-wing. See more of the B. We didn't see.
Oh
much.
Yeah. The Cohen Slayer B-wing. Yeah, that thing was a beast, though. I mean, the thing is, like the Y-wing, they complained about the Y-wing not being able to turn. Yeah, I mean, and that was still considered a fighter. Then you had the B-wing that literally couldn't turn. Like, to turn that ship was just. But I can imagine the struggles of that thing. You'd probably be trying to turn a C-15 Globemaster. It just not very easy. It takes probably need a wide circle to turn that thing.
Yeah, but then you have a ship like the A-Wing, which you just barely turn the controls and you're...
Yeah, hypermaneuverable, however, very light in armament. I mean, yeah. I'm surprised. I'm actually still surprised talking about that. We saw the A-Wing in any battle, let alone, like, no, it's such a major battle. It was almost like they threw everything they could at that point at the second Death Star, because the A-Wing wasn't a fighter. It was a scout vessel. That's why it was so fast. Because it was an interceptor. Yeah, it was an interceptor, and it was a scout vessel. They used it primarily for scouting. Because it was so fast, you can get in and out before you get caught.
One thing, I was a guy who was a guest on here a few weeks ago, Alan from Generation Tech. Shout out to Alan. He did a series of videos on the tactics of some of the battles. He pointed out some of the mistakes that they made. One of the videos he pointed out was the mistakes the rebels made in the Battle of Endor in space. And he pointed out that the smart move would have been to hug the Death Star, because that super laser, it's not very maneuverable. You can basically just shoot straight. And the closer you are to that, because the fleet's not going to want to fire at it, because they're not going to want to fire at the Death Star and risk, you know, either killing or, you know, injuring the Emperor. So you hug close to that Death Star and you stay safe. And then you just hope that the crew on the ground can get the job done and get that shield down. And then, you know, that, and with the Battle of Hoth, I noticed that those snow speeders, instead of doing the smart thing, which would have been going off to the side or trying to attack the walkers from behind, time and time again, they went straight at them.
Mm-hmm.
Just straight.
Yeah, the smart thing to do is be fly above them, because then I believe the only two lasers that could pivot up were the two side front lasers, which could actually pivot up enough to get them. It's a lot better than going full forward, going right into their full barrage of everything they have.
Yeah. I mean, it made for a cool visual for us, but militarily,
it did it. Yeah. Well, here's the thing, too. Even the Battle of Endor, think about it. Like, think about how lucky the Rebel forces got.
They took out
one of the Star Destroyers because an A-Wing crashed into the bulb, which was a shield generator.
Yeah.
I mean, that was luck right there. Or took out the bridge, actually, because the A-Wing slammed right into the bridge. That's right. And that was, that was luck. That ship was out of control and just so happened to take that Star Destroyer out that way. They took, like, it, they had luck on their side in a lot of those battles.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. It was all right. Well, I think we will wrap things up a little bit early today. So again, this has been War of the Stars, a Star Wars Roundtable podcast. As always, you can catch this and all the other great shows here at Realm of the Mist. Just remember to go to Realm of the Mist on your YouTube page. Click the subscribe button. Click like for this video. You can catch me on Twitter at mark.tolly and on Facebook at mark.tolly. Mario, where can we reach you at?
Okay, well, you can find my personal YouTube channel, SithLord310, and you can also find me on War of the Stars and doing movie reviews for Realm of the Mist.
Christina, where can we reach you at?
You can reach me on Facebook. I have a channel page on Facebook for my other podcast, which is That Trans Geek Girl. You could also find me on this show, as well as Breaking the Fourth Wall and Press A Gaming, which are all on the Realm of the Mist channel. And also, That Trans Geek Girl has its own YouTube channel as well, so check that out, because there are exclusives.
All right. Well, until next week, this has been War of the Stars. And as always, may the Force be with you.
May the Force be with you always.
Always.